بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. أما بعد، هذا الشيخ سيس المجلس السابع عشر 17th sitting في فضل صلاة التراويح والتهجد في شهر رمضان. The virtue of praying صلاة التراويح التهجد in the month of Ramadan. التراويح التهجد أن قيام الليل. They all have the exact same meaning. They all have the exact same meaning. There's no difference between them. Naam, but maybe in terms of usage, one could say that Tarawih is more specific to Ramadan. That's what Qiyam al-Layl and Tahajjud, that's used more so outside of Ramadan. But in reality, they're all the same thing. So if somebody calls Tarawih Qiyam al-Layl, because that's what is in some hadith. So for example, the hadith is going to come. The Prophet said, Man qama Ramadan iman wa ihtisaba. Whoever stands qama from the word Qiyam. Yeah? So the Prophet used that same wording. I'm going to get to that hadith shortly. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he says, Sheikh Salih Fawzan, hafizahullah, he says, Alhamdulillahi wa salatu wa salamu ala rasulillahi wa ba'd, fa salatu tarawih min khusaisi shahri ramadhan. The prayer of tarawih is something for which is exclusive to the month of Ramadan. Wa hiya sunnatul mu'akkadah, and it's a very emphasized sunnah. Bal hiya aakadu sunan. Rather, it is the most emphasized sunnah. Now this is referring to, it's a bit of a fiqh issue of, obviously you have the obligatory prayers, and in Kitab al-Salah, after you study the obligatory prayers, you study after that the non-obligatory prayers, the recommended prayer, the nawafil. So you study witr, tarawih, al-istisqa, the rain prayer, kusuf and khusuf, the eclipse prayers, and so on. So then the fuqaha normally mention, which is, okay, these are all sunnah, which of them are sunnah mu'akkadah. So one is normal sunnah, which are the emphasized sunnah, and which is the most emphasized sunnah. Okay? And they have the difference of opinion. This one because the Prophet never left it off, or this because of this reason, and so on. The Shaykh is saying is Tarawih. Another strong one is Witr. Because Witr is very close. And there are some ulama, especially in the Hanafi madhab, they say that it's actually obligatory, Witr. So they make it six obligatory prayers. However, the majority of the ulama say that it's sunnah, mu'akkadah. Then he says, وَقَدْ فَعَلَهَا النَّبِيَ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ يَصْحَابِهِ لَيَالِي مِنْ رَمَضَانَ. And Prophet did it with his companions some nights of Ramadan. يُصَلِّي وَهُمْ يُصَلُّونَ وَرَاءُهُ ثُمَّ إِنَّ تَخَلَّفَ عَنْهُ فِي آخِرِ اللَّيْلَةِ خَشْيَةً تُفْرَضَ عَلَيْهِمْ. But then Prophet stopped doing it on the last night. Why? Out of fear that he didn't want to make it obligatory upon them. So this also shows that it's a proof against those that say that, you know, Umar said, when he did, we got everyone together with 20 raka'at, that this is bid'ah hasana. It's not actually a bid'ah because the Prophet did it. The Prophet did it, but then he stopped because of fear that it's going to become obligatory. And that reason is no longer there with Umar, because Umar is not a prophet. Umar is not a legislator. So that reason, that fear, is no longer there. If Umar did it, it's not legislation, is it? No, so he just carried on something that the Prophet had already started. Now, and then the Sheikh talks about the importance of, especially the last 10 nights, the Prophet ﷺ should the mi'zara, he would, you know, as we would say, fasten his belt, or, you know, basically, there's something along the lines. And what that basically means is that he wouldn't go to his family, he wouldn't, you know, have a relationship with his family. وَأَيْقَظَ أَهْلَهُ, and he would wake up his, he would wake up his family. And this is all in one hadith of Aisha radhiyallahu anha in Bukhari and Muslim. She said that the كان النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم إذا دخل العشر شد مئزرة وأحيا ليلة وأيقظ أهله. And that's why the Sheikh said, وفي رواية وأحيا الليلة كلها كله. The Prophet said, would, you know, أحيا, he would give life to the night, all of it, meaning, you know, he would stay up the whole night worship from Allah. وفي رواية فلم يذق غضما. غضما is you would say to somebody, if they were to close their eyes, you would say أغمضَ عينيه, أغمضَ عينيه. So what he literally would translate it to, he did not taste the closing of the eyes. Me and the person do not sleep at night because of sleeping, due to being busy worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is narrated by Abu Naim in Hilya and Aqidi in Al-Du'afa, and Ibn Hajar in Nisan al-Mizan. Then the Sheikh says, فالحاصل ان صلاه التراويح سنه مؤكده. يكون بيميل اذا اتي السنه مؤكده. انا شيخ منشن احاديث منشن ان از نذر وان من قام ليله القدر هو بستان ليله القدر. سو فيرست وان واز من قام رمضان هو بستان رمضان. And this is more precise by whoever stands in the night of Laylatul Qadr. So now the Shaykh talks a bit about Laylatul Qadr and he says, وَلَيْلَةُ الْقَدْرُ غَيْرُ مُعَيَّنَةٌ فِي لَيْلَةٍ مِنْ لَيَالِي رَمَضَانَ فَكُلُّ لَيْلَةٍ يُحْتَمَلُ أَنَّهَا فِي لَيْلَةٍ أَنَّهَا هِيَ لَيْلَةُ الْقَدْرِ. Laylatul Qadr is not a specific night, so it could be any night of Ramadan. فَإِذَا قَامَ جَمِيعُ لَيَالِي رَمَضَانَ فَإِنَّهُ قَدْ يَضْمَنُ أَنَّهُ قَدْ قَامَ لَيْلَةُ الْقَدْرِ. So a person stands the whole night. Sorry, if a person stands every night, then he can feel safe. And guaranteed, Yadlam is guaranteed that he has reached Laylatul Qadr. And the Prophet said, "Man qama ma'al imam hatta yansarif kutiba lahu qiyamu layla." Whoever stands with the imam until the imam leaves, then it will be written for him that he has stood the whole night. So subhanAllah, if you just pray Salatu at-Tarawih with the imam, then it's like you've stood that whole night. And if you do that every day, then it is as though you have stood for Laylatul Qadr, you will be guaranteed that you would have stood the whole night for Laylatul Qadr. And the Sheikh, he carries on and he talks about how even some of the Salaf, they would never leave off Tarawih. And he said, وَكَانُ يُطِيلُونَ الْقِيَامَ حَتَّى رُوِيَ أَنَّهُمْ كَانُ يَعْتَمِدُونَ عَلَى الْعِصِي مِنْ طُولِ الْقِيَامِ. That's even narrated that some of them would have had to have a stick so that they could lean on, due to how long they would be standing. And that's narrated by Sa'ib ibn Yazid. He said that Umar commanded Ubay ibn Ka'b ibn Tamim al-Dari radiallahu anhumah to lead the people with 11 raka'at. And they used to recite very long, more than 100 ayat. So until we had to lean on sticks due to how long they would be standing for. And that's narrated by Al-Bayhaqi and Al-Malik, and it's authenticated by Al-Albani. And then the Sheikh says, as for us, then, and then there's another thing as well. Now, وَكَانُوا يَرَبِطُونَ الْحِبَالَ بَيْنَ السَّوَارِ وَيَتَعَلَّقُونَ بِهَا مِنْ طُولِ الْقِيَامِ. They would even tie ropes to themselves, because that would help them stand at night. And as mentioned by Iraq ibn Malik. And also, the Prophet saw some of the Sahaba radiallahu anhu do this, and he agreed with it, and he approved of it. And that's narrated in Bukhari, hadith number 1099, and Muslim 784. Muslim 784. And then the Sheikh says, as for us, we're lazy, even though the Salah now is a lot shorter than how the Salah was in the time of the Prophet. That's what a lot of people forget. The Sunnah, because there's always a lot of 8 or 20, right? And the Sunnah is 8, na'am. But there's two things in the Sunnah. First is the quantity, and the second is the quality as well. And in terms of quality, the length was a lot longer. So for somebody to do the whole sunnah, then it would be 8 raka'at, but it would be very long 8 raka'at. And that's why you find some of the salaf, they actually did more than 8, because they may have found it easier. And that's why some ulama are a bit more, they're not strict on 8 or 20, and they say, person does what is easier for him. That's why, Umar did 20, Imam Malik did 36, others had done 32, others had done 28. The Salaf, they did different number of raka'at. But yes, the Sunnah is 8. And with the number 8, the quality of making those 8 long. So the Shaykh is saying that even though we're doing a lot shorter, that in fact shouldn't be an excuse for us. And we shouldn't be wasting our time. Rather, we should be benefiting ourselves, especially in the month of Ramadan. The next chapter, the next gathering, the Sheikh talks about the virtues of Siyam, of fasting. Again, I believe he did so in the beginning. And this is good to remind ourselves of the virtues of fasting. SubhanAllah, we might, Ramadan started now, people might start getting tired. So this is where people, become a bit more relaxed. So it's good to remind ourselves of the virtues. So he starts off with the hadith, أَصَوْمُ لِي وَأَنَا أَجْزِي بِهِ, that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says in the hadith Qudsi, that fasting is for me and I will reward it. And the Sheikh mentions a number of different opinions of what this hadith means. Because this hadith, the ulama do differ. I remember we had a gathering with Sheikh Muhammad Abdul-Karim Ishaqi, and he mentioned some of these opinions. So go back to that, inshallah. And if somebody wants to put the link in the comment section, and with the time of what the Sheikh talked about it as well, that'd be very good as well. Because he didn't do the whole lecture on it. It was just a small period of time where he talked about it. نعم، وزن الأداء في التأييد المنشنة. صدى الشيخ says الصوم لي، أما بقية الأعمال فإنها لصاحبها تقربه إلى الله سبحانه وتعالى، ولكن هي عرضة للقياس للمظلومين. The Sheikh is saying that عرضة للقياس meaning that towards the end of the judgment there'll be a place, a time where if you've ever oppressed anyone, those people will be able to come and they will take from your good deeds. They will take from your good deeds. If you backbited them and so on, they will take your good deeds. And that's called qasas. Okay, so the Sheikh is saying that what Allah means by as-sawm li is that that will happen with all of the other actions apart from fasting. Fasting, Allah will keep. Allah will keep it himself and no one will be able to take anything from fasting. That's why he says over here, أَمَّا الصِّيَامُ فَإِنَّهُ يَدَّخِرُهُ اللَّهُ لِصَاحِبِهِ. Allah will hold it and keep it with himself for that person. And then the Sheikh moves on to the second opinion. He says, وَقِيلَ فِي تَفْسِيرِ الْحَدِيثِ إِنَّ الْأَعْمَالَ الصَّالِحَةَ تَضَاعَفُ الْحَسَنَةُ بِعَشْرِ أَمْثَالِهَا إِلَى 700 ضِعْفٍ. That is mentioned in some hadith, and there's actually a hadith specific, a similar narration to الصوم لي فإنه أجزي به. Before it, one narration, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he mentions that that actions are, the rewards are multiplied by 10 up to 700. And the Sheikh mentions a few ayat, but like I said, there's actually a hadith pertaining to الصوم لي, the same hadith, it's another narration, but this is mentioned. And then the Sheikh says, أما الصيام فإنه لا ينحصر بتضعيفه بعدده. لا ينحصر تضعيفه بعدد. نعم. As for fasting, then it's not limited to a number. بل لا يعلم ثوابه إلا الله. So subhanAllah, what this basically means is that all the other actions, you can say that this action has this specific reward and this action has this specific reward. But fasting, Allah says, no, leave that to me. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala being Al-Kareem, the All-Generous, the All-Powerful, you can just imagine how much reward he'll give a person. And then Sheikh, he says, and there's actually two actions where Allah has done that, where he's not specified a specific reward. The first is fasting, and the second is sabr. And he mentions ayah, إِنَّمَا يُوفَى الصَّابِرُونَ أَجْرَهُمْ بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ, that Allah will reward those who are patient with a ajr, with a reward, بِغَيْرِ حِسَابٍ, without accountability, i.e. without a number. And subhanAllah, this is the point that the Sheikh actually mentioned, which I was thinking of, but I never read anyone say it. So alhamdulillah, the Sheikh has said it. Which is that, and the reality is fasting is a type of sabr. Because sabr, sawm linguistically means al-imsak, to refrain. And that's why that's the linguistic definition. And the technical definition is refraining from all the nullifiers from dawn to dusk with the intention of worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So that's why the Sheikh, he says, لِأَنَّ الصِّيَامَ غَيْرُ مُحَدَّدًا مُضَاعَفَةً. لأن الصيام من الصبر, because fasting is a type of صبر. And the Sheikh mentions the three types of صبر, صبر على طاعة الله وصبر على محارم الله وصبر على أقدار الله. And he says that all three of them are found in, all three types are found in fasting. And the Sheikh explains, he goes on to explain that. And then the Sheikh mentions another ayah of reward. Allah says, كلوا واشربوا هنيئا بما أسلفتم في الأيام الخالية. That you know, eat and rejoice and enjoy yourselves in Jannah due to what you have done in the previous days, i.e. in this dunya. And the Sheikh said, Qila, meaning one of the opinions of this ayah, who this is referring to, إِنَّهَا نَزَلَتْ فِي الصَّائِمِينَ, it's regarding those who are fasting. Because they prevent themselves from eating and drinking in this dunya, so their reward in this and the akhirah is that they can eat and drink whatever they want. And this also reminds me of another hadith where the Prophet ﷺ said that there is a door in paradise, يُقَالُ لَهُ الرَّيَّان, it is known as الرَّيَّان. And that's the door of, or the gate of, for those who are fasting. And once those who are fasting have entered it, it will be closed and nobody else will be able to enter. And then the Sheikh, and the Prophet ﷺ said that, and whoever enters through this door, لَمْ يَظْمَأْ بَعْدَهَا أَبَدًا, they will never ever become thirsty ever again. Subhanallah. They will never ever become thirsty ever again. And then the Sheikh carries on and expands on that point. And then towards the end, he talks about the importance and the virtue of fasting generally. And he concludes with that. And we will conclude here. Subhanakallah, alhamdulillah, la ilaha illa anta, astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk.